Director of Deaf Biblical Ministry Reverend Younger Walling was on Thursday given the A. Kevichisa Citizenship Award 2023, while Anato Kechishi and Imti Tangid Pongana were given the Charlie Kevichisa SA Award 2023 in youth and senior categories respectively. The award is being conferred with the intention to celebrate and promote ideal of citizenship. The Kevichisa Foundation instituted the awards in 2017. Let's have a look.
The annual A. Kevichisa Citizenship Award, in short KCA, is instituted by the foundation to celebrate and promote the ideal of citizenship. The Citizenship Award annually recognizes an indigenous individual or group of Nagaland that has consistently championed, demonstrated, and embodied the ideal of citizenship and unwaveringly sought the common good of the people of Nagaland or collective sections and constituencies thereof. The award carries a citation, a beautiful medallion, and a cash prize of 3 lakh rupees. The award started in the year 2017 to celebrate the life of A. Kevichisa in honoring those who have lived an exemplary life through selfless service for the upliftment of the Naga society in truth and in integrity and in dignity. The previous recipients of the award are Ms. Moaminla Jamir of Mother's Hope in the year 2017, Reverend Dr. Chingmak Kejong of Eleutherus Christian Society in the year 2018, Dr. Wati Iyer of Oriental Theological Seminary and the Forum for Persons with Disabilities, that was in the year 2020, Mr. Huzo Meru from Shalom Bible Seminary and Northeast Christian University 2021, and we are honored to have him here in our presence this evening. And in the year 2022, it was Mrs. Nidonyo Angami, who was a pioneer, who is a pioneer social activist and founder of the Naga Mothers Association. Along with the first KCA award, the Chalia Kevichosa Memorial Lecture was held in the year 2017. This year, the foundation introduces the Chalia Kevichosa Essay Writing Competition, the first essay writing competition, with the theme Leadership in Nagaland. And we hope to have this as an annual event. This year, for the essay writing competition, we received 64 essays, that is combining both the senior and the junior category or the youth category. And going along with the times, the essays were put through the plagiarism test and the AI tests. And after being evaluated by a panel of judges of 3 members, we have this year 2 winners, one for the senior category and one for the junior category.
I am Mrs. Ipshita Datta, daughter of today's special guest, as announced by Madam, Mr. Rabajati Datta, retired teacher of Pranab Vidyapeeth School. Since my father is not physically in a position to stand for a few minutes and read out his speech, I, on behalf of my father, take the privilege to read out his speech. I feel honored as I am saying the speech on his behalf, so I'm using first person. Here I refers to my father. I feel honored that I have been invited to give away the awards to the winners of the Chalia Kevichisa contest. My thanks and gratitude towards the Kevichusa Foundation knows no bounds. I am fortunate that I had got the opportunity to be introduced with late Chale Kevichusa at the house of Mr. P.G. Banerjee. I was a tenant in Banerjee's house. Though I had a very brief interaction with Chale, I was mesmerized by his visionary outlook and dynamic personality. Mr. Banerjee had always been a trusted lieutenant of late Chale during his lifetime. He is a dedicated person and has always stood by the Kevichusa family through thick and thin. A man of principle that he is, I pay my respect to him. Chale died on the 23rd of September 1992. No, I'm wrong. The physical body of Chale died on that day, but his spirit is deathless. How can it die? It is still working and is inspiring us to stand erect in the face of all hardships.
Now we will be going on to the declaration of the result for the youth category as well as the senior category, and then we will be having the essay reading by the winners. But it is unfortunate that the winner of the youth category had an emergency, and we were told just today that he will not be able to attend the program. So his essay will be read by Imchalong Longchari, who is one of the great grandsons of A. Kevichusa. Yes, and the winner of the essay writing competition in the youth category is Anato K. Chishi. Can we all give a round of applause to him? I don't know whether he has sent anybody to come in his place to receive the award. No. Okay. So I will call Imchalong Longchari to come and read the essay, please.
Leadership in Nagaland. Nagaland, the pride I take in calling it my home, is the 16th state of the Indian Union, inaugurated on 1st December 1963. A remotely backward state comprising basically of tribal people with vibrant, jovial, and colorful atmosphere. And a board of culture, traditions, customs, festivals, and a rich heritage of the bygone past. A place where warriors once dwelled, engaging in warfare with each other, gaining accolades of heroism and honor by beheading their enemies and adorning the several heads as collected trophies. A fearsome ethnic people where traditions, cultures, customs, and laws were sternly adhered to. The people were presumed to be symbols of courage, majesty, authenticity, and dignified intimidation, something which is sadly non-existent today. Long have we come from the savage ways of life, and with no clear written record of the past, we can only depend on the word of the mouth passed down through the generations. The revelation of the past ways of life can be learned through the oral archives that made its way in the form of traditional folklores, dances, and songs. Traditional attires and the unique traditional ways of living as practiced by the respective tribes. The one common thing among the many shared, however, by almost all groups, the clans or tribes, is the way in which the leadership or kinship was followed upon. The system of governance in their respective lineage was always based on the reign and system of leadership that enabled the survival and expansion of the tribe. We are all aware of the saying, powerful man makes places powerful, and hence a man of power, might, and charisma led the tribe, ensuring survival of the clan or tribe. A leader was someone who could lead, guide, and drive the tribe's upsurge amongst the many enemies that existed. With imminent dangers lurking all around, it is the responsibility of the leader to safeguard the lives and to nurture the needs of his people in times of vulnerability to threats and crisis. In the atmosphere of uncertainty, the leader was the one who shouldered the responsibility of defending and conservation of the needs and interests of his people. Now, with the tides of changing times and with the rapid globalization of the modern era, the question arises about the sphere of how leadership has evolved or degraded in our land. It can be said with absolute certainty that there exist more problems, hurdles, and complications in the way of progress and development at present. But has the outlook of leadership changed even so at this very moment in our land? No. Matter what or how far we have come towards modernization, we cannot undermine the need of competent leaders to guide and lead us forward. And in the present scenario, we need it more than ever, lest we fall back behind to dark ages.
Next, I'm excited to announce the winner of the senior category. And his name is Mr. Imti Tangit Pongana.
So again, thank you to the Kevichuza Foundation for organizing this whole thing. So I'll just start with the reading. This essay actually has two titles. I think the first title would be, I call it What We Owe the Future. And then it's subtitled Leadership in Nagaland. So I'll just begin. It's quite short. At some point in time, we must all have seen it or something like it. It's an illustration comparing a boss and a leader. In the illustration, there are two groups of people pulling two heavy objects. Next to one of the groups, one of the men is shouting at his subordinates to pull harder while comfortably seated away from the group. In the other group, the man is at the front of the group, the first in line to be pulling the weight, while also motivating the rest of the men and taking them along with him. Which one would we say is which? Unfortunately, we cannot talk about leadership in Nagaland without talking about political leadership. But seeing as how for us, in any social setting, that is the topic that every conversation inevitably and albeit begrudgingly leads to, I felt a break from that topic when we talk about leadership would be refreshing, to say the least. What I want to attempt to do instead is to paint us a lens through which we can scrutinize and examine the leadership around us. Because just because a shoe fits doesn't mean that that person deserves to wear it. Oh yeah, so the under the theme of writing for a cause, since I decided to donate 20% of my winnings to an organization called the Internet Freedom Foundation. I don't know if any of us here have heard of it, but they're an Indian organization. What they do is basically they remind the government and big tech and even the people, especially me, that the Constitution exists. And they fight for our privacy, they fight for the rights of people. And the internet, which is something we use every day, is the way it is in India. It's free, it's cheap because of the people. Of the IFF, the Internet Freedom Foundation. They work every day and every night, and they run on donations. So I will be giving away my money to them. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Now we come to the second part of the whole event, and that is the presentation of the A. Kevichuza Citizenship Award. And to give away the award, we have a very special guest again. That is Reverend Bonnie Resu. And before I call him up on the stage for his speech, we will be having a time of felicitation now to felicitate both the chief guests.
Since this is a citizenship award, the idea of a citizen came to my mind. And so I thought I'll talk on this. And by the way, the essays were wonderful, and I think they deserve to be published. Really. From the Western perspective, and I plead the ignorance of the Chinese or the Indian philosophy, who claim to have more than 5,000 years of history. So I'm speaking from the Western perspective, from the little that I know. The Greek thinkers like Plato and Aristotle, who first systematized, if we may say, citizenship, because we should not assume that there were no citizenship prior to their mentioning this or coming up with this. As a means, they looked at it as a means of participation in public life for full and proper development of the human personality, so as to bring social peace. That was their goal for introducing the concept of citizenship. So in their mind, because it embedded power, Plato advocated giving citizenship only to a few, the guardians of the society. Whereas Aristotle advocated giving citizenship more widely to a larger group. So in their concept, especially of Aristotle, mere residence, that is excluding people who were already living there, mere residence, such as those who are slaves and aliens, or those who enjoy the legal rights of suing and being sued, or participating in election of legislators, or being part of the executive authority, did not qualify a person to be a citizen. So today in our day and age, we also have a lot of debate, discussion on citizenship. So I thought that is quite pertinent. The strata of society those days, we are talking about 2,500 years ago, was divided into broadly citizens, slaves, women, and foreigners. Unfortunately, women are not classified, or did not qualify to be citizens. Citizenship was not given to women or slaves or foreigners, not even to those engaged in manual and menial work. Citizenship was defined in terms of functions, especially participation in the judicial and also deliberations and decisions that affect the public life. So only those who are involved in those matters were qualified to become a citizen.
Thank you, Reverend Boni Resu. And now I hand over the time to Dr. Kethoser Kevichisa to introduce the recipient of the award.
Before I segue into announcing this year's recipient, I just want to make a brief comment about the essay contest. We called it the Charlie Kevichisa Essay Contest because Charlie Kevichisa was more than any other thing, more than a leader, more than a politician, more than a social reformer, he was an essayist. So we thought that that would be the best way to remember him. I also want to say a brief word about the A. Kevichisa Citizenship Award. Our president has already mentioned it carries a medallion, a certificate, a bouquet, and a cash prize of 3 lakh rupees. We started with 3 lakh in 2017. This is our 7th year. And all these 7 years, we have been hoping to raise the amount, but we haven't been able to win the lottery yet. So hopefully one day we will win the lottery and raise the amount. And I do hope some of you younger essays who are here this evening, I hope you will one day win this award, and hopefully by then the prize will be 3 crore or something like that. This year's recipient of the A. Kevichisa Citizenship Award, as you will have guessed by now, he was born in 1957, and he was the youngest of 7 children. He was born in Kar village in Mokokchung. From a very young age, he was observed to be a very diligent person, young fellow, in whatever he did. The seed of his primary ministry, the deaf ministry, or ministry among the deaf people, the seed was first sown when he and his wife, Mrs. Amungla, an equally committed woman, when they were working as special educators at the school for the deaf in Bangalore. At that time, he also served as associate pastor in the deaf church there. Then they received special training under an American, Bruce Schwalbe. And they realized that there was a need for a center for the deaf in our state, Nagaland. And of course, then such work for the disabled was, here's the irony, such work for the disabled was unheard of. And along with his wife, he founded what is today called the Deaf Biblical Ministry, or DBM, School for the Deaf. They founded this in 1987. The Deaf Biblical Ministry, DBM, it started off with only 6 students, purely by faith. One of their students, Aumeran, went on to become the first deaf person in Nagaland to pass class 10. The Deaf Biblical Ministry also won the National Award for Outstanding Institution in the Field of Hearing Impaired in 2004 from the then President, Dr. Abdul Kalam. And then another award was received by the ministry during the presidency of Pratibha Singh Patel. The recipient has been a member of the General Council of Rehabilitation Council of India, member of State Coordination Committee for the Disabled, executive member of Nagaland Council for Child Welfare, lifetime member of India Council for Child Welfare, member Zonal Advisory Committee for the Disabled, and an administrator of the Eklavya Model Residential School, in short, EMRS. He was also approached by the Department of Social Welfare to spearhead this school in Nagaland in 2008. And he has been playing a vital role in establishing this school in Nagaland, a school that is centrally funded for students from economically weaker sections. Another initiative that our recipient started was what is called the 80 Plus Mission. And this was started in 2006 to honor the elderly people of Kar Village in Mokchung District. Through this program, village people who are over 80 are given medical attention, health supplements, and other necessities. And this year, the program was again held on 25th November. Our recipient continues to be the director of the Deaf Biblical Ministry in Dimapur, while also shouldering the responsibility of being the administrator of the said school, Eklavya Model Residential School in Dimapur. So, ladies and gentlemen, after that longish introduction, but of course, someone like him needs a long introduction, but in another sense, needs no introduction, should not need any introduction. So with those words, we are very proud to announce the A. Kevichesa Citizenship Award recipient for 2003, and he is Reverend Younger Walling. Let's give him a hand. I now invite him to please step forward, and our chief guest to hand over the prizes to him. Do you feel the same? Will it make it warm like leaves you, baby? Don't care. This award is not just a reflection of my effort,
but a testament to the power of collective action. It serves as a reminder that a collaborative effort requires the dedication and passion of many, that no significant change is achieved in isolation. It is a call to action for all of us to continue working towards a betterment and more equitable world. Throughout my journey, I have been fortunate to witness the incredible resilience and strength of the human spirit, whether working to address social injustice, advocating for the persons with disabilities, especially with deaf community, promoting education, vocational skills, and spiritual well-being of those who were considered as a burden to the society. I've seen firsthand the transformation power of compassion and empathy. I thank God for many deaf individuals today who have been transformed into contributing citizens of the country. As I accept this AKBCHUSA Citizenship Award, I am aware of the responsibility it carries. The journey towards creating a better society is ongoing, and this honor serves as a reminder that there is much work yet to be done. It is a call to redouble our efforts, not to forget the challenges that still lie ahead. The work is far from complete. It is my desire to continue to uplift the lives of the people with disabilities, to work towards the cause of the deaf people, to break down barriers, and to create a world where individuals, deaf or hearing, despite their differences, has the opportunity to thrive and to experience their full potential and life. In closing, I once again express my heartfelt thanks to all those who have been part of my journey. This award is not the culmination of a career, but a milestone on the path toward a brighter and more inclusive future. Let us continue to work together, inspire one another, and strive for a society where compassion, justice, and equality prevail. May we continue to bring positive change to the society and leave a lasting legacy for generations to come. Thank you once again to the AKBCHUSA Foundation for this incredible honor. I am truly humbled, and I look forward to continue our shared journey towards a better world for all. Thank you so much. Now we have a special number by our deaf children. So may I call upon our deaf children to present a special number. Shackled by a heavy burden, neath a load of guilt and shame. Let's see.